A couple of notes about some of the images that you were seeing. Of course, the ones of the children. Those were mine. The rest. Okay. Yeah. There's going to be a lot of applause for lunch, isn't it? Okay. So the babies, Tanya, the rest of the panelists and the narrators from the project, with the exception of the one that had Gloria Steinem in it, I felt that I needed to include it because, well, it's a picture of Julian partner and, but, you know, we're Smith. Like, if we don't call the gods in, we might get this very well be cursed. So we have to sort of call Gloria into the room every time, so that's why I included that one. So I wanted to welcome you to this panel, Righting the Wrongs of Rock History, Women, Gender, and Rock. This evening is sponsored by the Women Rock and Roll History Project, as you know, which is a collection designed by, implemented by, conducted by, and curated by our very own Tanya Pearson. Tanya is an Anna Comstock scholar here, an oral historian now, a rock star in her own right, and one of our most beloved interns in perpetuity over at the archives. We think she's never going to leave, but love her. So, one of our most beloveds. I'm Kelly Anderson, and I'm an oral historian here at Smith, and I'm also the faculty supervisor of Tanya's work on this project. Tanya's project is extraordinary. For the wrongs that it rights, for the bright lights, the amazing bright lights that she's brought here at campus and locally, for unparalleled imagination and deep devotion, and for the gifts of all these new histories. Women of Rock is driven by an impulse that I think many of us share, which is a desire to be seen and a deep need to see our lives and experiences reflected in written record. When we don't find ourselves there, and honestly, most of us don't, the work of filling in the gaps is quite profound. Beyond the confines of a research project and into the deeply personal and quite political realm of storytelling, bearing witness, and creation of new knowledge. Yes, it's for future scholars and writers, but most importantly, it's for the young girls picking up guitars and microphones for the first time. I'm delighted to welcome these amazing musicians to our stage, but even more so to offer a huge congratulations to Tanya Pearson for this work.
Can everyone hear? All right, so I want to go through. Okay. If anything happens at any point or it shuts off, just start flailing around and I'll pretend like I can fix it. So I'm just going to introduce the project and then the panelists. I always say brevity is not my strong suit, and I've tried to make it as brief as humanly possible so that everyone else can speak. But I've been toying with the idea of starting an oral history project that would represent women who've been omitted from rock history, journalism, and scholarship. But it seemed pretty unfathomable to me that anyone would say yes to a 34-year-old college student with a shady past. So when I went to see Brute Assault in Boston last summer, casually lingered outside for an hour and a half, pitched an oral history collection that didn't even exist yet, which piqued their interest and got me their contact information, I knew that this was not only fathomable, but necessary and important. The older I get, the angrier I get, because my history is so often relegated to footnotes or supplementary categories. Women's history, LGBTQ histories, rock history, which I'm using as an umbrella term to represent multiple genres, subcultures, and countercultures, as well as the rock canon, but constructed as inherently naturally masculine, so women's contributions are consistently perceived as anomalous and less authentic, which greatly restricts their access to audience, which ultimately impacts who gets remembered, which ultimately impacted my ability to write a paper about L7. My goal was to start an oral history collection by women for women that represents individuals who've been left out of the popular rock narrative. My hope is that the Women of Rock Oral History Project will diversify the rock paradigm and promote inclusivity among a broadly defined definition of women, including genderqueer, gender nonconforming, trans, and other marginalized people, by giving them a platform to share their histories. Rock music and culture is a mirror image of patriarchal structures that privilege masculinity and delegitimize femininity. I don't accept agency within those structures. History is not static, it is malleable and should be inclusive and can be adjusted accordingly. I want to thank all of the interviewees of the Oral History Project. Some of whom are not here. Lydia Lunch, Kristin Hersh is here, Mary Tierney, J.D. Samson, Nina Gordon, the youth host of Group Assault, Julie Cafritz, who's at the end, Laura Balance, Danita Sparks, and Alice Bagg. I have not actually interviewed Kim House in Millington, but I will someday. and I have to thank all the people who help me and don't get paid, and they actually don't get much of anything, except sometimes I'm like, oh, thanks. Sophia Cassiola and Michael Epstein, who is somewhere filming, and they film everything and just like travel around with me, thank you. Kate Sumner, who conducted Laura Balance's interview and does transcribing, which is the bane of my existence and also of hers now. Maggie McDonald, the greatest graphic designer in Western Massachusetts, and quite possibly the world. Jason Lane, who does a lot of things. Tonight he is taking pictures. He's rented cars. Crystal Ford, Sam Behrens, and the people at OCQ in the back, thank you for playing music.
Love you.
Beth Myers, the director of Special Collections, who couldn't be here tonight, but for realizing the importance of this collection and not kicking me out of her office when I asked if it could be housed in the SSC because I'd already scheduled interviews. Steve Waxman and the entire American Studies Department for giving me money and support when nobody else would. And I'd like to plug Steve's event. Jessica Hopper will be here on Monday. She's a pretty phenomenal rock journalist. You should come to that. Graham Hall in Hillier. 7:30, sorry. accessioning archivist Kathy Nutter and the entire Sophia Smith Collection staff for tolerating me. Karen Kupiel, Zoe Feldman, and Bob Rosenthal for developing the Rosenthal Fellowship Program in the memory of Smith alum Becca Rosenthal, who is a music lover and an archivist. I hope this collection would have made her proud. Now, I want to introduce you to our esteemed panelists. And I did not know what to order, so I just was born in the Philippines and moved to California when she was 13. She played lead guitar in the band Fanny from 1969 to 73. They were the first all-female rock band signed to a major label in the United States.
Come to that, and you can also buy her books at the Merch.
seminal indie weirdo rock band Throwing Muses. Whoever they can listen to now would likely be influenced by the Throwing Muses. She's toured with and collaborated with Pixies, Talking Heads, R.E.M., My Stipe, among others. She's released too many solo albums to list and started my favorite project of hers, the Crazy Lab Group East 50 Foot Wave, in 2005. She's an iconic lyricist and songwriter, a mother, an author of the memoir Rap Girl, and most recently, Don't Suck, Don't Die, Giving Up Vic Chestnut. She's also a lovely person, and you can also buy her books after the panel at the merch table. I didn't write your name down. What is it? No, I'm kidding. J.D. Samson. J.D. Samson is an activist, a gender outlaw, songwriter, musician, producer, and visual artist who gained notoriety as a member of electro-feminist family Tigre alongside Kathleen Hammond's statement, and later formed DJ Project Men. She's performed with Peaches and collaborated and produced material for Christina Aguilera and Pussy Riot. She's co-founder of performance art group Dykes Can Dance, has appeared in films like Short Bus, and recently starred in a great documentary called The Last Lesbian Bars. Wrote a really important essay for the Huffington Post titled I Love My Job But It Made Me Poorer, and is probably one of the most visible figures of feminist and queer issues. In her spare time, she likes to bathe in bathtubs filled with $100 bills. Julie Cafritz is one of the coolest people on the face of the earth. I wrote that down so I wouldn't forget to say it. Because it's true, and it's important. She started the hugely influential noise rock garage band Pussy Galore in 1985 without even knowing how to play the guitar, and went on to form STP and supergroup Free Kitten with Kim Gordon of Sonic Youth. She's toured with some band called Nirvana. She's a mother, a teacher, a subversive songwriter, and lyricist who's been hugely influential in the underground scene. She was also on MTV Beach House and got to talk to Kennedy before MTV stopped playing music videos and fired Kennedy. Okay. So, that's... Okay, so everyone's comfortable, good time so far. Okay, because this is kind of like going to be a bit of an intellectual conversation because the point is we're talking about gender. But, you know, like, swearing is fine, casual is fine. I want everyone to be included, and I don't want to be, like, off-putting with language or complicated kind of issues. But I thought to introduce everyone, I thought we'd kind of go down the line. Since collectively your career spanned from the late 60s to the present and include a wide variety of genres, I thought it would be great to start with each of you sharing your experiences as women within your respective scenes when you were starting out. For instance, like Fanny had a really hard time gaining credibility in the late 60s and 70s, but like the LA punk scene was more welcoming to women. So just a little bit, you know, and if we could just be mindful of time to...
Stand up because no one in the back can see any of them. So I was just going to ask if any of you feel like you're going to stand up and make it so stand
up. I actually don't know if that is possible because of the tech. Yeah, like I feel like if you move anything too much.
Okay, you know, not to be smart and fancy, I'm sure all these people will feel comfortable holding the microphone. Just saying.
Oh, okay. I mean,
really the dark ages of women in rock because there wasn't anything that you could see around you that would give you any kind of a reflection back, whether it was positive, neutral, or, you know, who are you? So 64 was when we started our first band, but, so that's electric, but before that, when we got here in 61, my sister and I were playing acoustic folk music. So that's always a good entree to electric, and before that, is ukuleles. So speaking to how it was, basically it wasn't. I mean, we were the first all-girl band to be signed and record an entire album. Before that, there were some other girl bands, but they only did singles. So it was really easy to just do a single and just think these girls are going to go away, you know? And I always tell people that basically, I mean, we played because it really fulfilled something in us that was essential. And not only that, we're super outsiders because we're half Filipino, half English, Irish, American, but we were born in the Philippines. Our dad was from Burlington, Vermont, which I've been to a few times. So he's a Yankee, and my mother is an island girl, born in Manila, and as was I. So, and also I didn't know I was deaf in my left ear till I was 13 when we moved here, and I didn't know I don't have equilibrium on my left side till I was about 26 when I left Fanny. So, you know, aside from being other, which I'm sure all of you felt that whole other thing. I'm other, and I gotta claim something, so I'm not just a speck. You know, music, what we did, I feel, is we made a frame, okay? We made a frame that we could then step into. And what's so great about rock and roll is because we had no identity, no place. I mean, I was gonna maybe be a nurse. Okay, that's all right, you know. But to create a frame and step into it with electric guitar, electric bass, drums, and so on, that was completely different in 1964, late 64, you know. 65 wasn't that much better, but we got better. I mean, that's the main thing. We just kept doing it, and we kept kind of turning up. And 69 is when we really got going to Los Angeles. And I met great players who helped me on the road of shaping sound, not just playing notes, but shaping sound. And I kind of feel like that's where I'm at. I'm a sound shaper, and I'm also an educator at IA, which we founded for women in music. We've got this property in Goshen, 25 acres, a house, a barn that's got two recording studios and so on. And we're passing it on forward to the next generation. So we are playing it forward, and I'm so good to be so happy to be with all these great women, because seriously, I never thought I'd mention. I never thought you'd exist. So that's really cool.
His pedals and his guitar and his amp, and
And we were talking and talking, well, actually, he was talking and talking. And at a certain point, I thought, I'm going to do this. I don't want to cater to the rock star. I want to be the rock star. So I decided to take guitar lessons, which I'm not a great guitarist still, but that's beside me. I did take guitar lessons with some other friends, and they went on to be the guitarist and bassist in my future band. But the thing that I experienced later, when I was when I fell into the LA punk scene, was that the scene was so new that it was wide open, and we all felt like we could step in and create it and shape it, and it was whatever we said it was. So whether you played saxophone or a water jug with a wooden spoon, you could do that. And you could be a woman who only knew two chords, and you could get up on stage and feel welcome. And I actually was in a band where we wore paper bags over our heads. And that was liberating for me, because I felt like not only did I not have to present anything that I was emulating, but I could get up and just express myself as this bad creature that was genderless and had no other, you had no expectations except for, it was sort of a sort of mask, you know, so my energy was coming through more than anything else. But I know that now I'm going beyond what you asked me, and I'm giving my time. So I'm just going to say that for me, the experience of being involved in the early LA punk scene was liberating, because I felt like it was a new thing that was open to being shaped, and we as women shaped it. And I can't stress enough that the women in the early LA punk scene made that scene. We created it just as much as the men. We were involved in every aspect. We were the roadies, the musicians, the archivists. We were writing zines, taking photos. The early LA scene is often associated with the mask. And the mask, before Brendan Wallen could actually start booking there, he had to get some co-signers, because he was not a U.S. citizen, and those co-signers were women. So we were involved, we were there, and he refused to be kept out of history. Thank you, Tommy.
I'm the next oldest. I honestly get too fucking old to the point where I balled up, and yet I have to say, at least initially, my experience was completely opposed to yours, which is interesting, probably because of you. When my first band started throwing Muses, there were three women in the band, and I'm going to call us girls because we were 14 years old, we were girls. And I had been a classical guitar player for 7 years, since I was 7 years old. I was hit by a car, and I started hearing music, and that's what my band was. It had never occurred to any of us that we were female. It was never pointed out. Our goal was to write for human beings and other musicians, and I'm not sure I have ever experienced anything else except a publicist who offered to buy me tickets to the parties in LA and get me a stylist, and asked me what my demographic was. I said, I have absolutely no demographic. And I was kicked out of her office happily, and then read a preview of one of my shows in the Village Voice that said, attend if only to see the bizarre cross-section of humanity that will be at a Kristin Hersh show. The first time I thought, imagine if I wrote songs for single white females. I should be fired. We're human beings. I don't like the idea that men are people and women are women. And maybe the bigger picture perspective that comes from that we are not culturally either ready for or caught up with yet. I've been asked to teach at the rock camps for girls, and I say, well, can any of my four sons attend their pupil? And they say, no. And I'd say, I thought we were against gender segregation. And it's a tough call, because it has been a tough fight to get to where I got to be from where you began. And yet, I think maybe we need to differentiate between music and the music business. Memphis Many wrote When the Levee Breaks. That was music. Led Zeppelin covered it. That was the music business.
So I guess it's a game of how low can you go? And I can go even lower in terms of my lowly beginnings, which is that I went to shows. I was a college student. A lot of my friends were in bands. Their bands sucked. I thought they were terrible. And they weren't doing shit. They were just bumming around Providence, pretending they were cool in their shitty bands. And they talk a lot about their shitty bands. And I love to talk, and I didn't have anything to add to the conversation. So one day we were all standing around, and they were talking about their shitty bands. And I finally said, sort of, you know, if I was in a band, I'd fucking put out records, I'd tour, I would stay in a shit college town, playing shows for my friends, and thinking I was a big deal. And, you know, I was completely sincere, but I could have also said, if I was president today, I would ban nuclear weapons and put an embargo to stop apartheid. I mean, it was sincere, but it had absolutely nothing to do with who I was or thought I could be or what I wanted to be. Contrary to what Kristin said, I actually was in Providence, Rhode Island. My boyfriend was 15, he was friends with you guys. We went to see you, and I was like, who the fuck are those freaky chicks? I was like, no bands were girls. I totally saw her as a girl. I was like, what the fuck is that? Who are these little teenagers? And they could play, which was another sin, as far as I can tell. In that scene was that they were much better players than everybody else. So I left, I dropped out of school, and didn't think anything of it. And so imagine my surprise when about 6 months later, John Spencer, who I'd been in school with, called me, and he said, so were you serious? And I literally had no idea what he was talking about. But John was an asshole, and so was I, so I just was like, of course I was. And he said, so should I move there? And I was like, yeah. And I was like, I didn't know whether he wanted to fuck or whether he wanted a job, my father to get him a job. I had no idea what he was talking about. And finally sort of said, like, I heard you bought a guitar. And he was right. I bought a guitar over the summer. I'd been in a music store with a friend of mine who's a drummer, who would become our first drummer. And I bought it on just total whim. I dragged it home. He showed me, tried to show me how to play a chord. I went, that's impossible. And put it in my closet. So when John said, like, you bought a guitar, I was like, yes, yes. So I did. I bought a guitar. And then he was like, so you were serious? You want to start a band? We'll make records, we'll tour. And I was like, yeah, sounds good. When are you getting here? And he came a month later in September. We recorded our first 7-inch in October. And I never touched a musical instrument. Our first practice was the second time I picked up that guitar. And I got to string all the strings of my guitar were low E strings. Because that's the only string I could play. And I couldn't play that. But if it broke, I was fucked. So I just moved down as I broke them. And that was my illustrious beginning.
Living in Gainesville, Florida, and Long Beach, and then moving to LA, just nonstop music, so I was going to so many shows all the time that somebody asked me, like, you should book bands, and I was like, I don't even know what that would be. And then he's like, oh, you know, so many people go to so many shows and about music, you should do it. And then he just taught me how to do it, and then just after doing it for a couple months, it was like Alice was saying, it was like, well, you know, I could do this myself and be something that I wasn't seeing or wanted to see myself. And so I started playing about 2.5 years ago, and I hadn't played any instruments, and I still, you know, when it says multi-instrumentalist, it's like, yeah, like, what is it, not successful at one thing, but can half play everything. And it's a, I guess the, let me see, I got kicked out of the first couple of bands that I played with other people, so I started my own band. And I played bass, I write all the songs on the top string of the bass, and the recordings they were playing are all, I don't know notes to this day, I just play, like my journal says, like, second fret, third string, the different stuff, and just trying to play, you know, what you can with what you know, and just trying to do, you know, the best that you can with what you can do. I think something that, I guess my perspective is important today is about the, you know, people saying, like, they didn't have this, they didn't have that at that time, but maybe I have those things now, but giving a perspective of how those things might not still be positive. Like, for instance, having social media and all of that, I have that ability, but for instance, like, if I don't pay for PR or do different things, I won't be written about as much as my friends who pay for PR and things like that. Or things like social climbing, or if I'm not partying with people or personally friends with people or hanging around people, then, you know, I'm not going to be booked or part of things with people if I'm left out. If I just want to be home and focus on be myself and my hard work be the thing, that's often doesn't work very well for business. I'm usually written about from my performance and my clothes. My music is never usually mentioned. People have no idea what my lyrics are about, including my band members often that I play with. I currently play with people who are like, oh, I didn't even know that's what that was about. I think it's more just like this like hype or visual thing. And I obviously love visual with the costume and lights. I just wish that there could be all of those things and not just about the looks all the time. I also try to make it a point to say that I do write my music instead of it being like, I'm in a band with a bunch of men and like, oh yeah, like you probably started it and wrote all the songs, and then you are just like, cute longer, like go up there and get attention or something like that. And I want people to know that, you know, I make a point, and that's why a lot of people quit my band too, is because I won't let them be part of the writing process, because it's important to me to be able to have something that's mine and won't be taken away, and that I am capable of doing those things myself. I guess this feeling needing to be approachable by people and like hiding from who I date at shows and needing to be it's like always towards the sexuality, push towards that and stuff like that. Standing out for myself and speaking up because I do represent myself. I don't have a manager or any of that, and when I deal with promoters and stand up for myself or want things I think I deserve, it usually often leads to angering a lot of people and being isolated by standing up for yourself and what you think that you deserve. A lot of people say, female-fronted band, why don't I have an all-girl band? Why should I play with more all-girl bands? And I think that's all great, and I do that, and I like to celebrate it, but I think that, you know, that's still causing a divide, and I think it is funny that it always has to be the focus instead of it just being a non-thing. Like, just like, yeah, like, just like a band, happy to bring attention to it. Social media, I think, can sometimes hurt more than it can help, actually. I can go into more detail about that. And it's like having like that kind of like competition of like, I have to worry about Facebook likes, or like how many people are invited to the event page, or I don't have respect or something like that. And I think it's just all like high school all over again. So I don't feel like super lucky I have social media. I'm really glad I was in high school when it existed. I guess that's the other things that I can go into more in detail. Thank you.
Thank you. I'm a counterweight to those, I don't know if you read those.
came down to LA, we played with the set of home gig, we booked our gigs. All we really needed was just to kind of learn a few things about recording, which Richard Perry was really great as a producer and teaching us that. And now he has, you know, excuse me, a lot of, well, he was kind of controlling, super controlling. But, you know, a lot of producers are, I realize now. So, but where we did compromise was the clothes. I didn't like it, the clothes, you know, because when we got to LA, we were wearing our clothes, we did our own shopping, you know. And we felt, we wore the clothes we wanted to, first Fanny album, those were our jeans and our tops, you know. So I felt like we controlled that. But when they asked us to change our clothes, we went along with it, along with a designer. It was all kind of on the up and up. I really did feel good. I'd be standing on stage and we'd be playing this music and I'd be thinking, who am I? Who am I? I didn't feel at all. I didn't know Kiss was coming, you know? Kiss was like the next year. So it was kind of an all a prelude to Kiss. And I know, for example, Toshi Regan's a really good friend of mine and I'm her mentor. And she loves Kiss. She loves Aerosmith. She wasn't listening to her mom's music, you know? And I respect that. But when I was asked to wear those clothes, and I did, and I would be playing my ass off on stage, and I really didn't know who I was. That's when I had to quit, because I knew if I didn't leave, I was gonna die. I mean, somebody just told me that because I'm really kind of I'm a seeker, you know. So I knew I needed to go some third, go to find certain things, but I didn't know what it was, and I didn't know how to get it. That was scary. That was way more scary than doing that. Which was scary.
Script. I'm just like gonna mix it up a little bit.
Yes.
Kristin, I have a question about your experience as an artist, adamant about not producing crap, which is like a quote and it's true and that you said to me that you've said a lot. What was your experience as an artist, adamant about not producing crap, being signed to a major label in the 90s, and how did your experience ultimately lead you to develop alternative methods to get your music heard, and you're now basically like entirely listeners.
Music,
yeah.
NPR.
We started on a British indie label, and we're treated as respected musicians, as intellectuals, and in America signed to Warner Brothers, which we always said was like a beehive, and there was nothing essentially wrong with the bees, but the hive was evil. And I would keep trying to pinpoint individual bees and sit down in their offices and say, look at your record collection, it's good. Why do you sell crap? And they'd say, because crap sells. It's like, that's because you sell crap. If you really believe in a lowest common denominator, fool them into listening to something good. And that went on until I bought us off of Warner Brothers. And when I did so, I realized I was the only person signed. I was signed as a key member. And how I did it, because I was so poor, because Warner Brothers, we were selling at least a quarter of a million records, and each making about $2,000 a year. And I had no problem with that because I was playing music and I was on the road and it's not about that. I don't love feeding my children on the nights. I'm not address clothes. And I hate to do this, but the day, what I did was I gave them my first solo record in exchange for letting us go. And while I was working that, being a good girl, you know, like showing up for all the interviews and being my articulate self, thinking that I was a respected musician, they sent me to a photo shoot at Spin Magazine, and we had done all these songs, we had done TV, we had done everything that's generally considered tacky, and Spin thought they weren't tacky, but what they did to me was put me in a fashion shoot called A Rock and Roll Wedding, where I was supposed to marry John Stewart, who's not even remotely rock and roll. And, you know, not really. And I showed up, and like always at every photo shoot, there's this deflation in the room. And you go, okay, we got our work cut out for us. And in this piece, it was pretty bad. The woman in charge, the stylist, said she made me and the dude who replaced John Stewart, who decided not to marry me, just strip at the Chelsea Hotel in some room, and she's looking at my chest, and she looks so sad. I was like, well, finally, somebody's telling the truth. And she decides that I'm not the bride. And she says, she's a foreign, she's, I don't know where she was from, but she said, I'm not thinking you are a bride, I am thinking you are a maid of honor who fucks groom before ceremony. Shirt off, and the poor guy is just like goose pimpling. And it turned out that my costume was lacy underwear with the word bride sewn on it in rhinestones. And then, because I had been reduced to maid of honor with a spoon, I didn't have to wear that anymore. And the bride that they called in as an emergency had, like, you know, quintuple D. It was a nightmare, and it's a nightmare I've had many times since. And my publicist just leaned in and said, leave it. And that was it for me in the music business. That was when everything changed. Because the threat is, you cannot make money better unless you play the game. But if I had played the game, I would have lost all of the listeners who are
supporting me. JD, I actually have a question about punk rock. Going off the cuff here, okay? Because it's come up in conversation a couple times the past month, like me organizing the panel, and I always like describe you as punk. And you kind of, because you play mostly electronic music, get described as an electronic artist, or I don't know, a lot of terms that I'm not that familiar with, but, so I'm wondering what you think about punk. Is it like a style or an ethic? Because I think, I consider you to be punk even though your music isn't typically categorized as straight up punk, but from like the mode of production, the DIY kind of aesthetic, and, you know, making the music in your room. I think that punk has just kind of like progressed in a way.
Yeah, I mean, I think the reason why I consider myself punk or started from punk roots is because I am completely self-taught with my music making and production. And yeah, the DIY aesthetic is something that is important to me. Like, when I listen to something, when I look at something, when I make art, I want to leave my fingerprint on it. You know what I mean? So that's kind of what's important to me. But I feel like I listened to a lot of punk rock. I was really into all the like out punk bands in the 90s, and learned about them from Barnes & Noble magazines. And then when I went to college, I started promoting shows like for the Need and the Haggard, and eventually kind of found myself in the New York feminist punk scene, in which I met Kathleen and Johanna and Sadie, and then they asked me to join the band, and I had never played in a band before. So initially I was part of the band because of visual art, but I'm kind of straying from the question, mostly because I'm getting to the point that we began to make dance music as like a new thing for the Riot Girl audience for the reason that we wanted to dance in the same with the same kind of like energy and politics as we had all been doing with Riot Girl in an angry way. So we just wanted to like bring joy and movement and kind of body politics into a room through dance. So I would say that there wasn't a big difference to my reality as a punk fan and then my dance music production.
Sort of preemptively curtailing critics. But the fact was is that no boy I knew who ever started a band who wasn't somebody who hadn't taken music lessons, and there were plenty of people who were picking up guitars and starting punk rock bands who had never played an instrument. None of them ever got called out for actually not being musicians. And yet I was famously not a musician, you know? And then I just became aggressively a not a musician. And I didn't give a fuck that I wasn't a musician. I didn't give a fuck if that person was a musician. I devalued it. And I sort of regret that now, because when I stopped playing guitar, and then many years later picked up the guitar again, and I started playing it, I was like, hey, I'm pretty good. I had never given myself any credit. And in fact, somewhere along the way of being a professional musician for many, many years, I actually learned how to play my instrument, sort of. And I still don't know a single note. I can't read. I'm very much a, that's the fifth dot, isn't it? But I know my way around my instrument, and I can make my guitar sound really good, and I can write songs that I'm proud of within my own sort of very comfortable limitations.
Gerard Cosley said we weren't cute enough to get away with what we did.
Which was confusing. I didn't understand why what we did. It was so complicated. It was so frantic. It's just such a mess. Like, I thought cute people would do this.
I guess an important thing is just after I play shows and, you know, girls come up to me and just saying like, oh, I wish I could do what you did or do things or do stuff like that. And I guess like that's why bringing up the point to just like sort of bragging about like, well, actually, this is what I know or don't know or my limitations, because it's for me to be able to let other people know. It's like if they do want to do it, it's like it's corny. Like you literally can. It's like, I mean, and my, you know, abilities I think were also limited so quickly because, real quick, it's like I said I booked bands and then I was like, oh, I actually want to do this because I took dance for like 16 years. I've done theater my whole life, so I mean, performing was always there. It's just I didn't think I could, you know, sing or play an instrument, so I didn't. And then, I literally wrote these demos in my apartment, just like on GarageBand, playing the top string, the bass, and adding layers of simple drums and vocals and this and that. And I just gave it to a friend who was at a college radio in LA. And he's like, okay, I played them, I love it. You need a Facebook page, you need to book a show. Like, I was like, what? And then 2 weeks later, I played a show, and then I never stopped playing pretty much every week since then. So I didn't really, you know, I'm still trying to practice, but it's only been like 2 years. So I think it's just the point is, it's just like I said, doing what you can and, you know, not just, you know, like there's people like my dad who doesn't think it's like being a certain type of person to be able to be in a film like you wanted to, so then he just never did it. And then it's like if you just feel insecure, then it's like, I mean, people will pick at you for anything, so it's like, they're not gonna pick at you for being like, if I was the most skilled person, and it's like, because I'm too rich, then I just gotta hand it to me. I'm too poor, so people feel sorry for me, so that's why they give it to me, because I'm too this, so it's like, either way, you're screwed, so just do exactly what you want to do.
First of all, I think it's fascinating that, I'm gonna say that California term, you guys, would feel free enough and liberated and just go, fuck it, I'm just, you know, you have attitude plus. That's something I never actually had because I'm a Filipina, I'm not nice to those people. So, you know, I've only just started to say what I really feel now, believe it or not. But, you know, as you're talking, I'm thinking, I'm actually traveling through the sociology of the times because, you know, when our band was really just starting to get going, 1965, was when the Civil Rights Act was just being passed. I mean, feminism? That was not even until I started playing the Kristin in 75, so another 10 Here's what I even knew that there was a feminist like movement, but you guys, I feel like you're living it in some really essential, unfettered way that I really admire, you know. But you know, Jimi Hendrix and
because a man screams and it's strong. Miss Fanny. Oh, she's in trouble.
I like people being scared of me.
It's okay.
Yeah, I really enjoy that. I think one of the reasons that
they shouldn't be coming to your rescue.
No, they weren't coming to my rescue, and I'm not sure. I think of just, I mean, to me it was fun. I mean, when I listen back to look at your videos, I'm just like, that's so fucking great. In the same way that I would say, the Germans, that's so fucking great. And Alice as a performer is so ferocious. And I love that. I love that. But I, as somebody who also tends to go a little big. it just comes out or whatever. We were doing very aggressive songs. All my vocals really came down to screaming fuck you. Literally. But the intensity with which that message was delivered, I think was off-putting to a lot of people. I enjoyed that.
No, I gotta say that feedback, I feel like, serves that kind of same, because I would be screaming out of my throat. Feedback was a lot.
Yeah, there is an art to feedback. Yeah, sure. Yes, totally.
Okay, guys, wanted to do the Q&A. Would any of the audience, do any of you actually have questions that you're going to ask, or is it going to be, okay, so we're going to do that, and I'm going to do the final question then. But I would just hate to open it to Q&A and then we all just sit here like a bunch of assholes because no one actually has. Yeah, okay. So I'm going to ask my final question and then we'll open it up to Q&A. We can go over a little bit. I don't actually know if we can, but I'm just saying anything. Yeah, I'm just like, oh yeah, fine. I don't know. So just to close, the Women of Rock category is contentious because some say it reinforces gender binaries within the rock narrative. I have a solution that I have been employing, which my solution is to dismantle the notion that the male narrative is the dominant narrative by referring to men in bands as male printed bands. Because I don't want to erase the history of the women who came before by taking away the women. I'm like, what am I going to call this project? The non-cis man rock oral history project? I'm not doing that. Can I just expand the definition of women to include all of these people? So that's what I'm trying to do. But I really like hearing other people's opinions on it. And I know Alice and I talked about it in our interview, but just in closing, a couple minutes from each of you, your opinions on the women of rock category being categorized as women of rock. Is it more hurtful than helpful? Or what we can do along the line? Or does it start with whoever wants to start?
That's a tough one.
Okay.
I think whatever you want to identify, you want to self-identify as, it's fine.
I'm proud of being a woman in rock because it was, I felt like I was born. I could have been killed at any time for just doing it. So I'm proud of it. Everything that happened since then is just like, I'm just a woman in rock.
What are you saying today about being like a Lon, it was more like, I know that the interview is kind of more that, and I like that the visual or being a certain type of person represent anybody who relates to me at all, but it's just more about there being, in the review that there was literally, it never mentions anything about lyrics or music, is more the point I can say. And then it was only the focus, which is of course I put a lot of thought into visuals, I talked to lighting guys, hire lighting guys, and all the visual, I'm really proud of that. I just, as being a musician and I'm saying things for a reason, and I'm not drowning myself in reverb, but I'm saying something that I think is important to me. Like you said, it is therapy, and that's why the words are important, because it is something that, I'm getting out of myself about, you know, problems that I go through, like anxiety, depression, different problems, and if, you know, nobody's talking about that, and it's just like, oh, there's a crazy lady in a cheetah outfit, and it's like, how am I going to reach any of the kids? Like, I went to school for education and psychology to be a, you know, children's guidance counselor, too, so it's like I really wanted to be somebody who, you know, like she said, I do enjoy scaring people, too, on stage, and I think it's thrilling and fun for me, but I also want it to be more about, like, almost, I don't think desensitizing, but just making it so that other people that are going through hard things don't feel like, damn, like, she's doing that and acting so weird and scary and putting blood on her face and talking about all this fucked up shit, and, like, people think she's cool or, like her, then maybe that will make other kids feel, like, really resentful or shitty about themselves or issues that they have, and they won't feel like, you know, like, not like you want to make mental illness or different problems cool, per se, but I mean, you at least want to just make it that it's not so shameful, and that's, like, what I would like to do, at least.
I think the only difference between me and men in rock is that when I say baby, I mean an actual baby.
Had already sort of followed in our footsteps and created, but
But women tended to come and say, like, you know, oh, this is so meaningful, or I've had this, you know, and would relate to me in an emotional way, usually very appreciative. And male fans tended to be incredibly intimidated by me. And you know, their way of dealing with that would be to sort of show off, you know, by sort of reciting all the records that they owned, all the places they had seen me, all the things they knew about other bands that I had played with. In other words, like, you know, there was no you move me, or, you know, there was nothing except blather. And usually they were too shy to even blather at me. And what was interesting to me is, of course, sort of off stage, all I wanted to do was accommodate. I had this sort of ferocious personality when I performed, but that's not really my natural state. And I didn't drink, I didn't do drugs, so I was frighteningly sober after the show. And everybody was sort of drunk and stupid, and I sort of make it clear that I thought they were drunk and stupid. But in general, it was just sort of come, drink the beer, because I'm packing up my shit and I want to go. And the only people who could engage me were the female fans who just, I could have a real conversation with, or they, as opposed to the boys.
We're making it sound kind of safe, though. I do a lot of running away. Like, literally running down alleys and climbing to get a stage.
My fans were fewer.
It was a hard day's night. It was just like a lot of scary friends.
I had very similar experiences to yours. I think I was intimidated. But I think that people either get me and they love me, or they don't and they're stupid.
You have one fan and her name is me.
Something inspirational.
Well, I mean, I think for, I mentioned this a little bit earlier, but with La Tigre, I mean, that was like one of our main goals, was to create a safe space where we felt that women and queers and gender queer people could be safe in a room together, dancing and appreciating their own physical selves without any criticism from anyone else. And that was something that was the reason why we did the project, and that's pretty much been the reason why I continued working in the medium of dance music ever since, because I saw what joy that brought to people to be dancing in a safe space. So I don't know if that answers your question.
It is hard though that the music we play tends to be played in squalor. It tends to be funded by alcohol. It's usually played in the bad part of town where no one will complain about noise.
My experience was that because we play places like that, you couldn't necessarily control who was there all the time, and the best thing to do is to have people all sing with you. And in our case, we would just like, you know, if somebody was being an asshole, we'd point them out, we'd surround them, and like slam into them until they left. And in those days, a lot of us wore stiletto heels, which are really painful if you're pogoing on someone's foot.
So I wear really big boots. The closer we get to being able to mail music out and not having to have or even our the cartoon characters are asked to play the one-dimensional people you're supposed to be if you are striving to be a rock star and a punk star, which is never gonna happen. It's finally
I think a lot of times too that you can use whatever you look like or whatever you're trying to project as part of the message, as long as you're aware that you are presenting the message. You know, a lot of times people would come up to me and say, you were the first Latina that I ever saw do this or that, you know, stage. And I thought, oh, shit, I didn't even realize that I was sending that message out. I didn't realize I was represented. I thought I might behave differently if I had. But I think as you get older, you realize, hey, I didn't mean that message to go out. But now that I know that you're watching, maybe I'm going to dress differently or behave differently, or, you know, really consider my presentation. You know, like when you're a young artist, you might go to Joanne's and buy a frame and just go, that's great, I'm putting it on the wall. And if you spend more time presenting in galleries, you might think, oh, I'm going to make this frame. I'm going to make it part of the piece. You know, I think that happens to us as performers. We're performing all the time. You know, and even when we're off stage, even when we're signing books, it's part of who we are. So if you choose to wear whatever the fuck you want to wear, your attitude has to say, don't touch me. I'm performing, but you don't touch me. And I can assure you, if you like say it and look that person in the eye, they're gonna get the best.
You know, and I really think there is something to just, you know, like not even dressing like you're empowered or whatever it is you do, how about you just be that.
You know, because I feel like you can put out that energy, you know, this is what I'm wearing, this is what I'm doing, this is it.
Yeah, I
guess people respond to that. Sorry, it's simplistic, you know.
Yeah, and I think for some people, you know, what you said is valid for you. You know, if you choose to not be the face behind the music, that's great. But I would hate to miss out on like Bowie, you know, or Elton John wearing rhinestone, or Kim on stage. You know, like there's so much visual communication that happens that goes along with some of the music that I like best that I wouldn't want to rule that out.
I think my strength was in not being sexy.
Decided to extend it to 9:15, so we still have 45 minutes for meeting.
You can learn the rules and then break them. But
yes,
it's true. It's true. It's hard to get them out of your head. But if you become musically literate, which is possible now with music floating around in the ether, then you begin to refine your sense of aesthetics, and that becomes your language that you're fluent in, and that becomes what you have to offer that differentiates you from someone else.
I think the number one thing is to have fun while you're doing it. And the number two thing is when you start playing music with somebody else, make sure it's someone you really trust and love a lot.
That you can love us with.
Right. And then you just, you know, like you record it because it's on your phone, right? And then you have a printer at home, so you print out a label for that CD or. But I mean, I started off, all my bands, we had our own record label. We assembled our own records. You guys can do that. I'm local, you're local, so there's lots of places for open mics for young bands. This is actually a very supportive scene for young bands. And so you just sort of have to do it, as you say, have fun with it. But the first step is fine, or getting your hands on an instrument, but like the second you have your hands on that instrument, I'm living proof that all you have to do is stand in front of one of these and turn it on.
I think the most important thing is perseverance, like that I've noticed. It's like, you know, don't get beat yourself up when like the show goes bad or nobody comes or like you can't get a show or somebody doesn't want you or that, because I think the only difference between me and the other people in my scene is just literally just didn't stop. So it's just, you know, that's the only difference between, like, I think, in my experience, making it or not making it or doing well is literally just, no matter what, all the bullshit and everything that happened and people, like, talking shit or being mad or mean or this or whatever, it's like you just literally just keep doing it, and then other people drop off, and then you're still doing it, and then it's like, oh, look, that's it. So I think it's just perseverance is the most important thing.
One last question, 3 minutes. Who's had their hand up the longest? We just
best.
With when I was playing with women, you know, that wasn't that specific type of sort of bitchy comment, literally bitchy comment, came exclusively from men. Not to say that women don't bring their own complications to a room. So ultimately, I think you're right, you have to be playing with people that don't stifle you, that you feel, and I found people in both genders who helped me do that, and I found people in all genders who don't as well.
And there is the masculine and the feminine in music, for sure, but those are aesthetic principles more than they are people necessarily.
Did you get your question answered,
Carol?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, I just want to
add one thing, and that is that I know that some people did not get their questions answered.
Yeah, we're going to grab the time.